Welcome, sir, to the session. Good morning. I'm thankful to you for giving such a nice introduction. You see, basically, I am not a teacher, so I have to just engage me. Let's say if I am presenting something, if you have a point, please interrupt me so that we can have meaningful discussion. I would like to know how many of us are there today in this webinar. How many participants are there?
Right now, 41, sir.
41. So they are from different zones in India. Okay. So I think instead of what I have thought, instead of giving you total provisions and then reading out and then asking you to see para so and so building code, para so and so business manual and all, I have mainly structured the presentation like this. Let me go to presentation mode so that it can go to more. Okay. So I'll give you a brief overview of what's happening. Sanction, then how contract is administered and case studies of tenders and contracts, what can go wrong, how to solve a tender, where you have to be very rigid and where you can be flexible and all. Finally, takeaway if required, back in 10 minutes, then maybe hearing yes. And I always welcome suggestions from participants because nobody is perfect and one should keep on learning. Okay, first, just have a look at these six items which I have posed to the group. I include myself also because I am part of AVB and it's our bread and butter and we have been working on this for a long time. So these are the basic questions that we should ask ourselves. Is project execution slow on Indian railways? Are PSUs able to deliver whereas railway is not? What else deliberate project on Indian railways? Importance of organizational goal, then planning versus execution, and corporate plan of Indian Railways. On any of these items, if anybody has a reaction, an opinion, want to say something, I'd like to hear from audience if there is anything, any comment on these items. Okay. I'll go one by one. So, project execution. Do you think it's slow, which is the pace is okay, or means you expedite? But what is the opinion of the participants? Because this is one area where we were being criticized in past. Of late, we have improved our delivery, particularly if you talk about infrastructure projects. And I'll give you some figures so that you get an idea. Like, say, about 10 years back, we used to construct about, say, 1,000 kilometer or so of all lines put together on railways. But now that figure has gone up to almost 3,000 over the last 10 years. So, pace has improved. But this output includes output by PSUs also, like RVNL, some places, right, Sarvan is working on project, construction is working, Econ is working. So, all output put together is much better. But then the question remains whether PSUs are able to deliver whereas we are lagging. This question I leave it to you. If you have no reaction, think about it. Because some of you might have worked in PSU also, maybe on a definition basis, or you have joined for some time. And so you will have some experience because I have not done a PSU also. Then if you think that we need to improve the delivery of the project, what we should know, what is the reason why we are not able to deliver. Then, you see, organizational goal is very, very important. And unless each one of us have same goal and we work for that goal, it's not possible to achieve that goal. So goal has to be very, very clear. Like say, in a construction project, goal of everyone, like say, right from chief administrator of construction till the lowest rank person has the same objective, that this project has to be opened. Similarly, but then he also requires support from different partners. Like he has to coordinate with different departments for approval of plans, approval of drawing, etc. Give me a minute. Sorry, lecture notes is where I have said. Yeah, so when I say organizational goal, we should have a goal. Like say, where we want to be after 20 years. planning versus execution. I think probably when a project execution is discussed, we normally think of execution mainly. Planning part is something which is very, very important. And when I say planning includes site investigation, conceptual planning, your design, site hurdles, or legal hurdles, whatever you are likely to encounter, you must account for in the beginning of the project, and a substantial portion of the project. Like say, if we have a 6-year duration of the project, roughly about 1/3 should be devoted on planning, investigation, design, and anticipating all the hurdles that you are likely to encounter when you go to site. So, planning should be given to importance. This is one area where we are lagging. That planning part needs to improve. When I say planning means investigation, design, then your legal hurdles, etc. You should think with advance. Do we have a corporate plan in any reaction? Please hear from this item. Because corporate plan for Indian Railways, we had some document called Vision 2020 and we have some white paper, but do we have a corporate plan? At least I have not seen if any one of you have gone to anywhere, what is the corporate plan of Indian Railways? We can discuss that, but to my mind, to my knowledge, best of my knowledge, we don't have any corporate plan. Unless we have a corporate plan, we cannot work towards that plan. And it should be known right up to the bottom level, so that everybody has that goal in mind. Let's say I'll quote one example. When I was working in Malaysia on a double track project, the goal of the project, or you see, entire Malaysian Railway had a plan for this project that the travel time between Rabaul to Ipoh is reduced by 65 minutes by doubling the track. And if you go to any of the project offices, they will say, this is my objective, and goal is to commission this project within so and so. And there was a clock showing you have on so many 1 year, 11 months, so many days, and so many hours and minutes left for the execution of the project. So we need to have a goal and then a corporate plan if you need to achieve something in long term. Okay, just to refresh your memory, because some of you might be wondering how your work is sanctioned and how it is executed on Indian Railways. First of all, requirement of work. When we say requirement of work, let's say on a section, suppose you want to invest throughput of a line. Is doubling is the best option, or we can do something else also? Like say, if block sections are very, very long, 15 km, 20 km, we have. In that case, it is better to go for a block station in between so that your throughput will increase instead of going for doubling. Or maybe even if it is say 10 km, probably you can go for an IBS so that your throughput increases. So those options, I'm just quoting an example for anyone. Like say, if you want to construct a building, before that, we should explore the possibility whether any existing building should be, can be used for the purpose or not. So, requirement of work has to be defined or, planned very meticulously, whether we can survive without or a new work, or by supplementing an existing asset, or by utilizing an old asset, or alternatives must be worked out before we say that this is absolutely necessary and we must invest money on this project to offer. Okay, so once the requirement of our hand is established, that okay, this is the possibility essential, then the executive authority requires some basis on which work is to be sanctioned. So abstract estimate is prepared, then sanction of work is done by competent authority. Is a project mostly distributed before Ministry of Railways. Once a month is sanctioned, then you go by location survey, then you go for detailed estimate preparation. Once the estimate is sanctioned, then you start the contract and you go ahead with the interest of vendor and find that market. Please call for this mobile item. This is very, very important. These are almost like a prerequisite for the Minister of Tender. Okay. The basic thing is that if you want to invite a tender, you must have it either signed. Or if it is a new line or doubling project, you must assess your land department and you must see that land is available only, then we should invite a tender. The development drawing, let's say if you want to construct a building, where the building is to be constructed, it should be agreed to by all concerned and PUD should be approved at the appropriate level so that there is no dispute about site once you have awarded the contract. Then site investigation. Site investigation is essentially required because, like say, if you are in a coastal area, the geotechnical conditions might be totally different than if you are in a hilly area or in a desertic plain. So, site investigation is a must because that decides the type of foundation that you are going to construct. And that decides a lot of things, like say, how much time you need, what type of foundation, how much cost, construction method, equipment required, experience of contractor in that field and all. So it's very, very important that we devote time on site investigation. And I request all of you to be liberal if somebody comes forward with a proposal of say 2 lakh rupees to buy an equipment or to provide a quotation that I want to investigate site, because you will find that if we are not devoting time on this item, and that leads to problem later on. Once you have investigated site, then you must have finalized your design, plan, and technical specification of the work. Flow of fund used to be an issue. Currently, I think it has been streamlined. Of course, we have problems here and there, but on a broader perspective, if you look at the availability of funds for last 7-8 years, there has been improvement, and it has become more or less a question of delivery, whether we can deliver in a time-bound manner or we cannot deliver. Then tender documents, including specification, special conditions, etc. These are the prerequisites, which is no longer executive, that you must be ready with all this before you invite a tender. In case you do not do all this, then after finalization of tender, you will have problems. Like, you give a time period of say 18 months or 2 years, but you will end up in a situation where you are not able to place the work after 24 months or 36 months. That happens. Any reaction on this item? I have reactions from the audience because, as I told you, I am not a teacher, so please react. Please ask questions so that we interact.
Audience can unmute yourself and ask.
Better so that we have an interactive session because I'm not in the student teacher.
Yes, you can unmute yourself.
Those who want to ask questions, they can call with the video also so that we can have interaction. Please feel free because nobody has answered to all the questions under the sun. And I also don't have. So we will discuss it. Maybe I am able to answer your question. Maybe I learn something from you. Okay, so I'll give you one example before I leave this slide. How important a design and technical specification can be. All of you are well aware that when we either do a track laying work or we do a design work for the work, we keep on joining rails by a process which is called aluminothermic welding process. It's nothing but a portable foundry process through which you join two rails using a technique whereby you heat up the rail and then keep a mold and of almost a similar composition, you mold the metal and then you pull it and try to join it so that there are no significant joints to improve running and reduce maintenance cost. So this thermic portion currently is being manufactured by outside, mostly vendors who are in Guwahati. So they have only one plant at Lucknow. In 2018, basically our railway board instructed South Central Railway to strip it back. If we look at, you know, our experience, like say, in setting up a plant, we don't have that expertise because our job is different. So once a job is given to railway, like say, in the month of December, our general manager at the time got the call from home. Immediately following the letter also came from home. So we took almost 2 months' time to prepare a detailed project report, how we are going to do it, because we were not having an idea. And then we sent DPR to board. It was a board said that okay, DPR looks suspect go ahead. In the month of April they sanctioned the work, another March, that's on February probably. They censured the work also and prepared our proposal at a cost of 21 crore rupees. Then, you see, as it happens in railways, you are always under tremendous pressure to float it in. And I was the one who was supposed to set up this plant. And, of course, divisional team was there and I had to guide them and add to the situation. But they also don't do it. So, this thermic portion manufacturing is totally a different about. Like say, something in common it has got with cement manufacturing, like say, rotary kiln for heating up components of thermic portion, like say, mill scale, steel chips, to a temperature of some 700 degrees centigrade. We need a rotary kiln which has to be automated, saturated temperature, then it has to be cooled down, then it comes out. Similarly, auto batching plant. It was all new to us. Auto batching plant is very common in case of liquid manufacturing. Things for even your industries which have, which manufacture pellets, but they have a different setup. Like, say, somebody is dealing with liquid, somebody is dealing with material which is not standard material. So, within 6 months' time, I was driven to specify something at the bottom of the report that you called it. But I was not convinced that unless I know the ins and outs of how it is manufactured. And what I expect out of this roasting process, what specification I adopt for rotating, what specification I adopt for my water batching plant, where from material I can get. And also, finally, after 8 months' time, public thought that it's right time to talk to railway, but what they can do. Then I got a call from my ex member and board that you have to decide this. And they invited them without any delay. Then I raised my hand saying that unless I do my technical part of it, I cannot ask my divisional team to go and tender. Because we do not know what they want from a tender. So one has to devote time and take a stand also. Because if I buckle, my divisional team will go for a tender. And we do not know what we want out of the tender. So this part is very, very important, especially if you are doing your work, which is not a routine work. Even for routine work, one has to prepare. Okay, so let's go ahead. Tenders, once you have finalized, then you issue letter of acceptance. Thereafter, site should be handed over, that should be on paper. Then you execute the contract agreement, then work is commenced. And it starts administration of contract. Administration of contract is very, very important in the sense that the authority who has invited, who are all supposed to administer the contract, they should keep on going through the contract documents and keep on assessing whether there is a need for any revision of quantity, whether some items to be added, some items are not getting executed and all, and what are all the requirements of the contract. So, just see this, cyclic chart once, then I'll give it. So, as I was saying, all concerned are supposed to go through contract documents. Then site must be handed over in writing. Design specification drawings are to be handed over to the contract preferably through a clear communication. Then if it's a project site, quality control labs are established, then site order book has to be opened. Site registers are maintained for quality control records. Then again, the cycle continues. Like say, you have to keep on reviewing what is happening at site, what improvements are required, or whether anything is lacking in the contract conditions, either your authority or contractor's authority. And the site order book is a very, very powerful document and must be opened and used. I'll put an example that gives you an insight of how powerful a site order book can be. Like I was in charge of a doubling project one in Maharashtra. As you know, Maharashtra has a very acute shortage of water particularly during summer season. It was month of May. I went to site, I found that earth work has commenced, but adequate water arrangements are not there for addition to those swales and compact units. I asked my DPC and the agency both why you are not following my specification. They said, sir, it is Maharashtra, it's not possible to drain water at all. We will not be able to get water from anywhere. So I had two options. I argued with them, I fired them. I did not do anything. I simply asked for site order book and entered my observations. They said that work should be stopped and so on. Till such time, water supply arrangements are made for site work. And compaction is done properly and it required compaction, degree of compaction is achieved. Those who are familiar with the project execution, they will agree with me that I have achieved the outcome of the project. So by the time I came back from Nanded, the agency was already informed CEO that CE has stopped the work and I will not be able to do this work. Next morning when I met to CEO, was aware that I have stopped the work. He asked me, why did you stop? I said, sir, ये क्वालिटी का इशू है और मैं मार्केट में नहीं कर पा जब तक ये कहीं से अरेंजमेंट नहीं करते। You will not believe after 10 days time, finally they realized that there's no way other than organizing water from somewhere and doing quality work. So it all depends on involvement and using your authority. Site order book is very, very important. Similarly, site registers of quality control records are very important and must be maintained. Okay, so important point for you from this is, let's say, the specification drawings. And again, you see, if the moment we realize that there is a, let's say, you have finished some 60% of the project, then you feel that quantities are almost about to be over for some items, that means it requires a revision. So, you must assess quality and then we try to process for variation in time instead of executing first and then going to balance or post trend to approval of variations. Okay. This is what I was discussing. Like, say, reassess the cost of work. Variation, if any, to be worked out and processed in time. And if you are asking agency to go ahead with the work, that should be on record. Then progress of work needs to be monitored, flow of fund, and timely payment is one issue which we have to ensure so that agency can deliver in time with whatever fund he has invested on the project and the money rotates faster. So, this is contract administration. One item which I think I don't know about all the reviews, but some of the reviews that I have watched. Once a project is finished, that means work is completed in all aspects, completion drawings are to be prepared, assets are to be handed over, then revised public completion estimates are to be drawn, and completion reports are to be prepared, and financial closure of project is to be done. Okay, any of the participants, can you give me an idea how many CRs are to be drawn on your railway? Wherever you are working, maybe a project organization, maybe open line, maybe some PSU. Can anybody give me an idea how many CRs are to be drawn on your railway or unit? Please react, I think, so that at least I get a feel like whatever perception I have, maybe my perception will change about completion reports. Please switch on your video so that I can see and see your reactions. Nobody has any question? Nobody has any reaction? So, flow of fund, of course, as I said, this is no more an issue, but then adequate funds must be ensured for the work throughout its project life so that you are able to finish the work. And even if say there is a fund crunch, then you must prioritize the work which are to be taken up early, which can be deferred. And also, this is about flow of fund. Okay, this is definition of first content. Please go through it, then I'll decide important points. Yeah, somebody is saying something? Your voice is not audible. Somebody is talking, but your voice is not audible. Okay. I hope you have gone through. Basically, you see, it's nothing new. It's a part of the code, 81201. Now, basically, basic, you know, thing is that it has to be enforceable by law, and a person competent to do a contract and free consent of parties and for a lawful consultation. These are the basics of, you know, first contract. Classification of first contact, if you look at normal in old days, we used to have, still we have zone works, then special works, then some building materials. These are traditional civil contact, but we have a wide spectrum of work materials for all the departments. We have service contracts, we have contracts for cleaning of platform, we have contracts for, you know, housekeeping. So a lot of things have come up. And lump sum contract, civil contract, and piece work rate contract. Anybody has any doubt about this, please ask so that I can clarify what is a lump sum contract, what is a civil contract, what is piecework or rate contract. So lump sum contract is something where, you know, you ask someone to construct a room for you, right? So you tell them that I'll pay you. So it's a $50 basis. And what all will be there in a room, it has to be decided in advance. And it is to be agreed upon. Then schedule contract is something where you have a detailed schedule, like say if a room is to be constructed, then you will excavate foundation first, then you will do this concreting, then you will do brickwork, you will do column, you will come to metal level, you do roof casting. Everything is, you know, piecemeal, so that is called schedule contract. Then a rate contract is something where you have a unit rate, like say DJ Sandy rate contracts. Unit rate is fixed and government departments can place orders and get those items through the DJ Sandy rate contract. Then I think EPC is very, you know, hot these days, and it is being discussed by railways here on top. EPC, and people are trying also on projects, right, that we can do. Why can't we do engineering procurement construction? There is a certain value of the project or contract where restrictions are there, probably 50 crore or 100 crore. That beyond that, you have to do EPC. If you are not able to follow, then you have to get somebody's approval. Yeah. Am I not audible? Please speak a little louder.
நம்ம லாஜிஸ்டிக்ல இது பண்ண முடியும். நான் நோட் பண்ண மறந்தாரு பேர் பண்றேன்.
மிஸ்டர் சரவணன், you can talk to me. You unmute yourself, then you talk. So, EPC is basically engineering, procurement, construction. So EPC contract has different aspects, like say engineering functions, basic engineering, like a concept of project, detail engineering, you go for detail design, drawing, then planning how a project is to be executed, then construction engineering, that means you have to take care of construction areas. Then it has procurement functions, like say you want to buy certain things for a project or a building. So he will get it for you. Like say if you are constructing a classroom, he will get your desktop, he will get you a system where things can be displayed, your furniture, everything. So depending on what you have kept as part of this content, you get all the requirement. But these functions are to be, you know, basically specified very minutely, so that there is no risk, because EPC is something that you agree for a certain amount and the agency agrees for doing a certain work for you, and that work has to be defined very well. So these are the procurement functions that will price for something where you will price it for you. Then construction functions. So when we say construction, it's not only say building. They will give you, say, let's say if you are constructing a fence set, they will go for erection of your gantry also, they will buy crane for you. Digital installation means all lighting, all conditioning, whatever is required for the building. So it's a compartment or the domestic part. It's a concept of even once the project has been commissioned, if you want their services, they are with you for your after sales services also. Then suppose you have a manufacturing plant, you want, they will agree for a quotation after a certain time. So these are basically EPC, so engineering, procurement, construction. These are known by different names also, like EPC is also called lump sum turnkey projects. Or there's one more version of engineering, EPC, which is basically called EPCM. So we will come to that later. And these EPC contracts are basically governed by bidding conditions. What is called international practice of consulting engineers, then they have a different general conditions of contract and all, and methodology is totally different. Those who have worked on a personal project, they will probably have an idea how this is to be governed. Then there is something called EPCM also, which is being talked about, and basically it is a service contract. Okay, so as I was saying that before invitation of tender, we need to have certain things in place. So engineering code also says, lays down that what are the documents which forms the integral part of the contract. It says conditions of contract, it could be standard or special specification, general specification or special specification, then schedule of items, quantity of dates, agreement from for instruction to tenders, tender forms. Then it says all the specification drawing must be ready before you invite a tender. Then this is all about, you know, basic of tenders and contracts. Now we come to case studies. Here I'll request all of you to please be attentive and interrupt me, because unless you interrupt me and ask questions, probably I develop a feeling that I'm not able to communicate what I want to communicate. Okay, I'll give you a background of this case before I go to slides. But, you know, glass butt bending, I hope people know about glass butt bending, but as I was discussing that, one of the methods of bending of rails is gymnothermic bending, which is done at site, and that is a portable foundry process. There is another process of heat resistance bending, which is called glass butt bending. Here you heat two ends of rail electrically and then you press it with a force, so that in hot condition this metal joint which is bent continuously. And about 10 years back, this was the prevalent method of building rails on a project, because our capacity of long rail in sail or mobile plant, stationary plant building capacity in Chandra was very low on Indian Railways. Okay, so this specific case I am discussing, so the case was at the age of 2010 when I was sea construction, I just joined on promotion. So basically the large number of projects were targeted in the year 10-11, and Southern Railway had a target of about 160 km line construction, where rails were to be built, pre-rails were to be built using wild transport building plant, and railway had no contract because of the month of August. Bid tender was opened. The tender face value was 23.19 crore, supposed to be a big tender at that time. I was junior most chief here, but given this was for the operation, that you finalize this tender. The, the additional information that I would like to share with you is that first tender was discharged, although lowest offer was 19 crores some 4 months back on some technical ground. When tender was invited, lowest offer was 20.24 crore. So you can see that face value is 23 and you got the offer of 20.24 crore and previously it was 19 crore. So the important thing to keep in mind is that when we went for tendering for second time, the cost has gone up almost by about 1.2 crore. And you have a 160 kilometer target where you require this transport building in field. Please go through this, criteria. This is the general criteria, but just have a look so that you get some idea of what I'm talking about.
I hope I'm audible. Yeah, I think the
Audible, na? Okay.
Very clear.
Okay. Yeah. Please react to this document. It's a, you know, more of a finance thing. Yes. Than whether this document can be accepted at EMD or not.
During question hour, I will unmute them to.
Okay. Somebody wants to ask question. Because you are not there to ask questions.
Yes.
But somebody is still talking. I don't know who is in the background.
Yeah.
If anybody has a question, unmute yourself. And then I want your reaction to whether this document is valid EMD or not.
समय से ही जाते
हुए
I muted to all, sir. Please unmute yourself because there won't be any disturbance by others, sir. Kindly.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Now it is only for you, sir.
Okay, fine. So, if you look at this document, it says that PCM Cement Corporate Private Limited. So, it's sort of a document and this is the front page of the EMD document submitted by a party. The question is whether this is a valid document or not. So we wrote to local branch of State Bank of India and asking them whether this TDR can be encashed by NCO Construction of Rural Area or not. And whatever reason I had, it came to that bank said that it cannot be encashed. Just go through the endorsement of the bank on this side. Let's say that see this endorsement of the bank. It says that normally it is written non-transferable and generally for security deposits it has to be FNCO or department and account contact, which is not true in this case. So this is how EMD issue could be solved, because on reverse of it, this entry was there, which was probably not dorsal entry, and it said that hypothecated to FNCO or something, but was not a document which can be accepted as EMD, but this was the only name since it was a high value tender at the point of time, and committee was under tremendous pressure from the trade quarters to qualify someone, to disqualify someone, so that somebody wins, somebody loses. So this was one document, but one thing which I wanted to share with you that In case you have doubt, please go back to bank and ask them whether you can in cash or not. Okay, so this was one issue. So we came out of this by clarification through bank. Then second item is your credential now. Worker credential. Normally, the moment a worker credential is talked about, we have in mind that it should be signed by taxi authority because they are the ones who are getting the work experience and they should issue the certificate. So this was the work done credential submitted by ITC Kanpur, the lowest tender, along with the tender. If you look at the bottom, this is signed by Deputy FA Construction from Northern Railway. Now, previous tender was also discharged on a ground, not exactly this, but similar ground, that in that case, the certification of credential was not done by authority who was a J grade officer, and on that account, tender was discharged. Here also, tender committee had a different opinion. Now, members are saying that how a Deputy FA can issue a credential certificate for a contract which is handled by executive. So, what is the way out? You see, one way, easiest way out is that you discharge tender on some building ground and then you go for region. But as I told you in the beginning itself that we had a 19 crore offer, then we came to 20 point something. And if you discharge tender, you lose that opportunity of opening a project and cost is also going up. So, these are the questions. Why worker certificate from NS officer? Should tender be discharged or should we go ahead? If you discharge, there is loss of, there is a chance that there will be answer loss to railways and target, etc. cannot be met. So, finally, what we decided as committee after a lot of debate that we will look for a positive option. Of course, we cannot talk to tender once a tender has been opened. So, we went to our counterpart, still I recall the name of the person. It was Aditya, Deputy FA Construction in Northern Railway. And when I spoke to him, he said, yeah, I have issued this document because this is a railway board contract and I am paying authority. And different railways, including your railway, has utilized this contract for building of rails. So, based on that, we contacted Deputy FA and finally we sent our officer for 7 days' time who got all the documents. And credentials were verified, and it was established that the lowest tender has done the required amount of work of similar nature. But this requires, thorough consideration, and you have to do your hard work. Somebody has to go to Delhi and he has to camp there, get the data. If you look at verified credential data, which is opening now, I'll repeat for you because it's confident of us here. If you look at this document, complete details were given. Like for the qualifying period, say 1472 313, how many bills passed, invoice details, then folio of case file, work done period, then number of joints, date, total payment made, service tax reduction reference, payment of service tax, payment of PVC, payment of shifting of plant, all items were there. And if you look at summary, finally it says that 8.35 crore is the total payment made to the firm. And our requirement was something like 8.1. So, the lowest tender for credential were verified like this. So, two hurdles were there. First was EMD issue. Second was burger credential. And finally, since there was a president, the same firm had quoted less rate, so we called him for negotiation, but he did not reduce rate, saying that market conditions have changed and we will not be able to reduce much. Of course, notional reduction of rate was done and the tender was finalized. So in a 2 months time, we finalized tender with all this problem and one lot of negotiation. And rates were better than what was already in, you know, being used in different contexts on adjoining railways and even on open line. So the message is that in case of tender, you have to be very careful, but then you need to deliver also. So this was a case where delivery was absolutely essential to for the project, and by finalizing tender, probably we saved money also, because it was much lower than our estimated rates, and that was based on tenders already in force on open line and on other railways. Okay, so this was the first case. Second case is which deals with, you know, similar nature of work, how it is to be interpreted. This is a case of construction of major bridge between Nanded is a doubling project. So I have shown the location of these bridges. These are between Purna and Limbagao stations, and other one is Purna and Limbagao and Nanded. So these are very small bridges, 3.1, 3 into 6.1 meter span and 6 into 6.1 meter span. This project is already commissioned and trains are running now. Of course, it's a long time ago. So, 8 years have passed since this case happened. Okay. Please have a look at these figures. Like, say, tender was opened on November 13. Tender value was 4.86 crore. And these were the offers received. Like, say, I have not given names. We will discuss the names also. And these are the, you know, offers. If you look at 4.86, 4.95. A simple one, then second lowest, third lowest, and all. So it appears to be a simple case. This is the go through the bold portion of criteria. That is very important when you are part of tender committee. You should understand what is the single nature of work and how much route of credential qualifies for single nature of work. It was any bridge work involving open, tile, build foundations, or any work of only substructure of bridge involving open pile belt conditions for a minimum value of 55%, that is 1.7 crore rupees. You see, briefing note was vetted, and then there was an observation from the finance also that description of work potential include do not seem to be similar to the description of similar work as notified in the tender. The same will be reviewed at the PC. It was a tender being done by my DPC construction, and C of the project at that time. So I was still hard. It appears to be a very simple case, but it was not so. You see, the L1 had two partners. If you look at their, you know, composure of the firm, we had two partners, and one of the partners of L1 had been banned by Railway Board on June 13th, and we are talking about, you know, November and all 13th. However, the partner banned, what he did, he exited of this firm before the ban came into effect, and his wife became the managing partner of the firm. She was already there and she became the sole partner. Managing partner of L1 and partner who exited has same office address also. Now the question is whether this firm should be considered allied firm or sister concern and treated as bank firm or not. So that was my question, which committee and executive authority had to decide. You see, a law branch opinion was taken. So there were different opinions, like say, if you look at their opinion, they will see, if the doctors have their opinion, then they will see that industrial review will be taken by the doctor or concern, something like that. So basis was, you know, what can be basis and what it was debatable, like whether it's a sister concern or not. I'll go to this, you know, chapter of particular business manual. Please see this. What it says, what is a bank public, what is a sister concern? It defines. It says that Para so-and-so defines allied firm as all concerns which come within the sphere of effective influence of the band suspended parts have been treated in order to state that following factors we take into consideration whether management is common, whether majority interest is held by partners or directors of the band suspended fund, whether substantial or majority shares are owned by the band suspended fund by virtue of this intrinsic controlling voice. So these are the conditions which are to be kept in mind, and then what is the allied form. Then IBM further says that there is some Supreme Court judgment which clarifies that merely because members in a business are related, it doesn't amount to family business, like that one of the members of the family has a control over other business. Unless said business form from fund of the family concern. This is the first opinion of the law officer when the case was given to them. This said L1 is neither allied or existent concern of the sole proprietor who has been banned by railway, or not the experience gained by which banned on the ground that bus were granted when the bank contract was its family partner. So this was the opinion, and then the moment this opinion came, it was again because Deputy CE Construction, the convener and the committee had a different view, and they thought that this is not a case where we can go ahead. They again referred it back, and law officer gave opinion that unless there was some document which shows that harassment is a controlling voice, we will not treat them as sister concern. So being chairman of the project, I was worried, and of course DC was also worried that one day he came and said, sir, I am not able to go forward, but we do. Then I advised him that why don't you do one thing, you both see the all the documents that we developed and reviews from the fiscal tender process. So what came out was that, in the meantime, the moment we had opinion from law officer about L1 that work can be given to them, for them, there was a complaint from lowest offer, lowest tender, saying that law officer is biased and is trying to favor L1. So we referred to higher authority who agreed with the views of law officer. It was almost February, so we came from December to October to February almost. 4 months time was passed. Then I told Deputy CE that day that the committee should go through the entire document submitted by the firm and see what is on record. The lowest tender was RR Construction, and it so happened that the person who had been banned, the document submitted by the firm shows that even after June, when this firm was banned, he has signed bills for claim and submitted to railways. So that document became very handy and conveyed to us that although this person has retired from the firm officially, but he has a controlling voice. Why there was a complaint? So to understand, let us understand that, because tenders know much more than what officials know. They had that the person who was complaining, he had a different interest. Of course, not in the railway interest or officer's interest, no. So the two things are important. One is that the L1 firm was finally considered as sister concern. So, and the third tender knew that the L2 doesn't have financial credentials because they did not meet the 150% criteria. So, the game plan of third person was that he will get the work if these two fellows are disqualified. So, second was already a clear case, and first one also after that. Yeah. Somebody is stuck saying something? Okay. No problem. Okay. So, when we went to law officer with this document, law officer said that yes, it is a case of sister concern and cannot be considered. So finally we could decide that okay, this is a bad part, sister concern, and to be treated as bad. So L1 is gone, L2 is gone. And while the L3 was behind it, that will come. But discuss now. This is, a work of the credential that L3 had submitted. It was a work of earthwork information, extension of major ridges, platform, and other materials for structural diameter, so-and-so. So, credential submitted by tender, as has been observed by finance also, that it doesn't match exactly with the prescribed requirement in the tender documents. Because similar nature of work is this, and the one that he has done is this. As I was saying, I'll take a minute, give me a minute. Saying that law of Sarnoff, it says that L1 is to be considered as elastic for the bent form, and hence it is also bent and the topper becomes invalid, and L2 is not having credential. But you see, why, in spite of all this, there was a problem, because the third lowest part, tender, was having a different reputation, and no officer would like to go against him and tell him that. Telling on record that your credentials are not okay. So committee in its wisdom said that no, credentials whatever is submitted, it meets the requirements. So I had recording on file that it's not meeting with the requirements. So this is the movement of file. First it came to me on 6614, then it came on 10th, I returned on 10-6, again it came back to me on 1814, 7814 I returned, 8914 again came on 16-9. Discharge tender against recommendation of tender committee. Discharging recommendation of tender committee, then you have to give your speaking order, because you are not agreeing with committee's recommendations. You have to give your speaking order. As I told you, basic issue was, it was a bridge work. And if you have a bridge work, you can compare only with the value of bridge work done by the firm, and I was showing that basically the work that was done by him is earthwork information, extension of major of this, date form, all put together had some value, and the required portion was less than value of 1.7, 1.8. So I still recall that was a Friday, and I got speaking order and sent the file back. That person probably got information. Of course, he should get, because it is discharged now. But probably he had access to file also. So he started sending messages to everybody, my CEO, general manager, member engineering, advisor vigilance, ED vigilance. He sent a message to everyone saying that this manager asked me, because he was asking for money and I did not publish, so he is suspended. Please have a look at the speaking order, because this is very important. It was a 3-page DC, and how much I had to write, because whatever I had in mind, whatever things I had to substantiate, I have to substantiate in advance. I cannot give any argument after I have recorded my reasons. My scope of saying anything is over. Seeking time, please wait. meantime, we will see how the case has moved. So, tender opened on 26/11 and finally I discharged on 17/9. And there was an official complaint to Business Wing on 29. You see, when such thing happens and the message goes to higher authorities, everybody is taken up. So, as I told you, it was Friday evening and I gave my speaking orders and I discharged it up. Monday morning, normally, you see, you are back to work and you will plan things, but I got the call from Senator GM that GM is calling you immediately to come with this file. Of course, file was with Deputy CE, so I called for the file and met General Manager. He was upset with the text which agency had sent to him. And I told him, sir, I have not done anything wrong and let this case be investigated. Let the truth come out. So finally, GM sir said, call the file in detail and then probably file. Circuit with him and finally passed it to the agency. And agencies include did their job for 6 months time and they found nothing and file was returned back. But the issue is, you see, it was not that committee did not know. Committee knew that the work credentials are not okay and still they recommended just to provide, you know, number from the person. So that should not be done. If you know that somebody is not fulfilling criteria, either financial or physical work criteria or any other criteria that you have to stay, you have to be at least professionally honest. But in this case, committee had basically set up already just to have a convenient time with the agency that we have recommended and she has discharged. Okay, let me see if document has opened.
Tells you that
three things. One is your document must be looked up. You check very carefully. Whatever documents you have, full documents the committee must see in the beginning itself. Because whatever happened for 3 months' time, they could have heard it. Like say the first opinion of the judge, second opinion, then third opinion. So of course the third opinion was a waste of time because document was there on file. Tender case file. So delay can be minimized. The similar nature of work has to be defined very clearly and everybody should get have same interpretation when they go through your similar nature of work description. As I was saying, so finally, after this case, similar nature of work was modified in constitutional language. Okay, so how much time we have? Anybody can help from Sitara? How much time is left? It's about 1:30, till about 30 or what can change? So that I deposit work by Government of Maharashtra for centennial celebrations of the, you know, Guru and things, birthday, I think 100th birthday was there or something like that. And they came up with a deposit work. What happened was that the fund, although they provided 10 crore rupees in time, but they did not sign that, they did not give anything officially and they did not agree to, you know, hear all the costs, whatever happened, is required, near the execution of work. Once that celebration was over, this work was not completed, then state government started delaying. They did not want to give any further funds. Of course, this RUB is now executed, but the lesson is that we should assess the scope of our work very carefully so that we don't have to go to state government time and again. And you do not start the work, particularly deposit work, if state government is not agreeing to conditions which is to be agreed to by state government for deposit work. This is a case of, you know, 142 grants at Nanded. So the background of case is like this. This is just a system map of Nanded itself. Mudkhir is here and almost close to his Nanded, inside Nanded. So it is a case of 142 grants which we require for housing our PRT crane. You can see the constructed portion of the set. It was basically a part of Kodakola gas conversion project. And initially, in the beginning, right, of 2009 case, division was wanted to be done at Kodha and they wanted on other CVs. So, based on division request and credit given, construction had already. IT said, can you help? There is some. Okay, so before the work was taken up at Kodha, which is almost about say 56 km away from Nanded, the divisional headquarters. As it happens, change of guard, and once you understand the reality of that, you know, system, now Nanded is wanted, a crane head at Nanded. And they wanted this bus to be stopped at Kodha and to pick up this same work at Nanded. So when general manager went for inspection, general inspection to point 10, it was included in his inspection note that this field of Kodha should be considered at Nanded now. This is the extent of GM suspension note, saying that how the what basically those who are from southern to little bit, they will understand the dynamics. We had, you know, loco sets, steam loco sets at Kodha, and we have a huge colony and lot of people are posted there. So if this grain set was there, they are happy and they can be part of, they can be deployed on these assets, they can be managed Kodha. The moment you ask them to come to Nanded, probably they are used to, and you have to either be harsh or you have to convince our counterparts or unions that it is required. So from Purna, the decision was taken away, taken that it will be shifted. Then site was not finalized, so with intervention of general manager, site was finalized and the work was started. Work was almost completed and some more funds were required to complete the work. When the asset was almost ready, and the contract was about to be completed, what happened, since this was a old GC project, the funds were adjusted because some force saving came in, there were no funds in this work. So, with curtailment in scope, work was completed and this much money was required. But the crux of matter was, nobody was willing to take over this asset now, because there was a change of mind again that no, instead of landed, again this should be considered portal. And I was the construction PRM, of course, told me that you constructed portal. Then I said, I am last person not to do it because we have invested partly at Kurna. Again, we came back to Nanded. We have nobody is taking up asset, taking over asset for last 1.5 years. Something went in him to place. We complained to our PM. But see, this case tells you that unless you are very sure about the location of asset and your requirement, work should not be taken up. Ultimately, it's a waste of money. Finally, see, even on date, 140 ton crane remains at Purna, and this shed is at Nanded. It is being used for some other purpose, not the main purpose, for but then such things can be avoided provided you have a plenty of thought and decision is taken currently based on the facts. Okay, this is something which I would like to share with you. I hope everybody understands what is ultrasonic fault detection of rails. Okay, I'll explain to you because you are not aware fully about this. Whatever sound we are able to hear, it's audible range. And beyond audible range, we have a higher range frequency and lower range also we have. So we use higher range frequency ultrasonic fault detection. For that, we use that frequency. The purpose is to, rails are manufactured in any plant. It will have certain flaws, inherent flaw at the manufacturing stage, or when we do welding, it can have certain flaw. Due to traffic also, we have certain problems develop over a period of time because of stressing of rails. So there is a mandated problem that rails are to be tested at a certain frequency. Like say, traffic is say 80 GMT, I have to test rail every month. If it is 60 GMT, I have to test rail every 2 months. Something like that. So they are just numbers for the commitments. So testing of rail is something which if it is not done and if the flaw grows in the rail, then this could lead to failure and lead to derailments. So basically it is related to safety. So direct safety concerns are use of the testing of rails. We have practiced that whatever resources you have departmentally, you use that resource and then balance what you outsource. So we had a contact in space and the bulk of was back. You can see the detail here, like tender was awarded in. '17 with completion period of 12 months, and value was 11.42 crore. Original quantity was executed as per schedule and calling of first tender was initiated. And as usual, so we went up to 129% variation. So the time was almost completely and the value went up to 14.25 crores. 100 was under violation, so we went up to 140% with the approval of, you know, message officer and whatever need to do for, you know, for such variation, supplementary agreement for the senior level. In the meantime, we finalized another new tender because we are already approaching 140%, so that agency was asked to submit PG. So 22nd October, we decided the tender and they were asked to submit PG within 60 days time. It so happened that the party did not come forward to submit the performance guarantee. We had to terminate the contract by forwarding EMP. But now the issue remains, how do you carry out testing? Because your in-house capacity is insufficient for adhering to Sri Lanka inspection of USFD testing. So this is a case where probably variation beyond 150% is justified. That's what I want to convey. Next day, what I did in that case, since this was happening, so I went to my general manager. I told him, sir, this is the situation. Most likely, I will have to come and request you for variation beyond 150%. I don't have any option because I have finalized tender and the guy is not responding. So, and we have to continue with rail testing. Then, even we went to our counterpart in finance and we told them, so we processed the case knowing that this is one turned out with finance concurrence and GM's approval. Finally, we went up to 200%, and we have in the meantime we put another tender. So the message from this case is that at times variation becomes inevitable because USFD testing of rails cannot be put on hold and agency which was finalized is failing. But rail testing has to continue if you want to run rails safely. So such cases should be looked into with a different angle as compared to normal variation proposals. I fully agree with Manan's view that normally we should not exceed beyond say 120% or in some cases 40%. If you at all you want to vary, start in advance. As I was saying, that administration of contract is very important. So that tells you that as you the work process, you have to reassess the quantity of work and variations. If you want, you can go for, if possible, go for another tender, or if you want to process the reason in advance before execution. So this is a case where the variation beyond 150% was inevitable. This is the message from this case. Okay. So, what are the important points? Make a base from, you know, this discussion what we had so far for last 1.5 hours. Change of mind after sanction of work is something which needs to be avoided. And railway is badly affected by this. That we decide something at one point of time when the project is being planned, and then when it is to be executed, or when it comes to stage of sanction, and then real planning for execution, then because of change of guard, perception changes, and we want certain more things. That is something where again project is being. Then at times, you know, central projects are being questioned and advisors which may or may not be correct. At times it will be correct if the project, but most of the times, once a project sanction has come, it has already gone through all the channels and then finally it has been sanctioned. Lateral thinking should be limited, you know. If you, let's say, you want to save money, there are different ways of saving money, but if you want a facility, you have to invest. You cannot depend on somebody else to create a facility for you. For let's say, you cannot bank about state government for your facility. Let's say, for remote areas, if you think that the state government is constructing water and they will give it to you, no. They are constructing for their own needs. Then, you see, rate-based surveys on budgets is very, very important. And this has to be seen from a different angle. Like, reconnaissance survey is a rough work. It cannot be of the same accuracy as an location survey. And there will be variation between abstract cost and detailed estimate cost. So these are kinds of life which needs to be accepted and understood. So every time you cannot stick to the gun that nothing beyond abstract estimate. Because abstract estimate is something which was prepared based on certain information without investing much of time and money. So there will be a variation between abstract and detailed estimate. Then, see, if somebody comes to you with proposal for use of technology for site investigation, for survey, etc. Be liberal with them, because there are only few people who think of planning, design, investigation. Encourage them, because planning a project properly is something which helps the organization in long run, and the completion period is shorter comparatively if it is planned properly, and the completion cost is much lower. That completion report is one thing which I am worried seriously, because each railway will have figures in thousands. Like say on our railway, I recall it used to be about 1300, 1400 CRs to be done. And whenever there is a review meeting, PFA sir will present that I have so much for construction, so much for this digital, that digital, and water. But once we do a project, the best thing is that the same team should close the project instead of handing over to somebody else who is not competent, who is not part of the project, and that fellow will be struggling or will not do it. Availability of funds is another issue. Of course, this is not there now. Then, use of technology like say software, your gadgets, artificial intelligence, these things need to be encouraged, because ultimately it is slowly we have to reduce our manpower, and only technology can help you or replace manpower requirement. So the use of technology has to be encouraged on projects and on railways. Okay, I'll just share one experience that we close to one. So, I was working on an international project in Malaysia that was 2005 for 3 years. It was $1 billion project, 180 km long, and it was a meter gauge track, I emphasize, because meter gauge, we have a perception that speed potentials are very low. But this project had two purposes. One was to doubling of project and then increasing the speed to 160 km per minute. On meter gauge track. Project duration was 24 months, and as I was saying, substantial project time has to be devoted on planning and investigation. So 24 months for investigation. When I landed, it was already 18 months time. So being from Indian Railways, and what I had seen here, that project means execution at site. When I landed there, I still recall I had my chief resident engineer with the system on the project that you have a chief resident engineer. Different type of experts will watch. I was an expert there. So when I asked my CRE, Chief Resident Engineer, Mr. Chu, was a Chinese guy, why Mr. Chu, why we are not at site? We have already lost 18 months. He says, wait for 6 more months. Our planning, design, investigation time is 24 months. Then you will see that there is no stopping, and you will be, you can see that thereafter that we will be working all 24 hours and on throughout the year. And that came out to be true after 6 months' time. That project had a freedom of taking technical decision. Like say, if Indian Railways or in case of all the other departments also, if you have entered into a contract, changing even a minor thing is very, very difficult. You think of equal opportunity, you think of complaints, you think of who will approve and all that. There I found that if a technical decision is required, you can take a decision, and then it is not seen from other angles. If it is a required decision, you take it, and so on. Apart from timeline, quality of delivery was, you see, there were only two constraints. At that time, Mr. Mahathir Mohamad was CEO of the country, Malaysia. Once he came to project site, he said only two constraints are there. One is timeline, whatever is scheduled is fine. Second is delivery. The quality of delivery has to be of excellent standard, whatever you want to do, but quality should not be inferior to any world project. So this is the experience on this project. Then takeaways, as I was saying, always some goal has to be supreme. Like say different individuals, different departments, but then if railways goals are not met with, it is of no use. Team working is a must. Like say we are from different departments, but ultimately we should work towards delivery of projects which is of common good, common masses. Then common public cost to be kept in mind. And I have been emphasizing planning investigation process to be encouraged, and liberal views on investigation expenses to be taken. Cases where we do not have expertise to be outsourced, demanding environment, discuss things with methodology. this we have to accept that we are not expert of this. If we don't know, go to experts. Spend some money. They will tell you what to do, how to do. Instead of, you know, start doing yourself and then you learn it to trouble, then you go to expert and try to find a solution. Important areas are obtention of knowledge. A lot of people, right, my personal group, not official. And people should work for some time in private sector for a few years' time, then they realize they're working. And they improve also. Like once I worked in Malaysia, I improved a lot of improvement in my technical skills. Even on personal level, I gained a lot. Like I had to drive my car, I improved my phone. Because there's nobody there. So you learn a lot of things. Then sense of responsibility towards financial goal is a must. Unless we all think in the same direction, financial goal cannot be achieved. And use of technology for scientific management, for project management, and then the project management is one area where a lot of developments have taken place internationally. We are lagging behind, we don't use any tool, we don't have any management technique. It's all whatever Newton will do, that is the final. That's all I think I want to share with you. Now, your turn to ask questions because nobody has been allowed to ask a question publicly. So, you can come forward if you have anything.
Yes, participants, you can unmute and ask any
questions. Ask questions. All are welcome to ask. I think we have 40-41 persons. Nobody has any questions. Remaining for that, one who has been associated with Sitara for a long time. Normally we have questions when you are talking. What's that? You have question session.
Actually, they were around 66-68, like sir. Now it has come to 44.
44. So, and sometimes nobody has a question. I don't know whether I was not able to communicate or audio was not there. Normally there should be some questions, some interaction.
Participants, you can ask any question.
Not only is it.
Look on the center.
They didn't know this project, this presentation. If you have anything else also, you can ask. Make sure whatever you have some comments, you can ask me.
Some are expected in Hindi, sir. That is also one of the things.
Okay.
It is very much clear. No problem.
Okay.
Please the.
I'll share that PowerPoint. But you have to share the PowerPoint.
Yes.
Okay, so with your permission, I'll close the presentation.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That was an interesting and informative session. The Academy thanks you for sharing your knowledge and experiences on the platform, sir. Thank you very much. I also thank all the participants for this wonderful session on this subject. Thank you, sir. Okay.
Thank you.
The topic for Monday is inspection and check of station accounts. Login time is step above. The session will start at 11:30 up to 13 hours. Thank you.
होता क्या इसलिए गुजरा
है मैंने समय से सब सामने